Thank you so much, Kelvin. So good morning, everyone, friends and colleagues. It's really my pleasure to have the chance to participate in this important and exciting event. So in the next 15 to 20 minutes, I'd like to share with everyone some ideas, concepts, as well as empirical findings from behavioral science research. So from the sustainable Singapore blueprint to the zero waste master plan, right? So Singapore has initiated and also, you know, planning a series of exciting plans, programs, you know, in order to promote environmental sustainability, right? So I'm sure that all of us here are very fully aware of the three R's, right? Reuse, reduce, and recycle. And but at the same time, I think individually and collectively, we also know that there is more that we could do, right? And so in fact, our domestic household recycling rate decreased last year from a previous 22% in 2018 to 17% in 2019. So from a behavioral science perspective, what are some of the main barriers that are stopping people from doing environmental friendly behaviors? Right, so I'd like to share some of these barriers. So the first is that, you know, when we think of actions, you know, that might allow us to keep the environment green, you know, we often experience a self versus other conflict, right? So we know that some of these things, you know, might be good for the society, might be good for the environment, but at the same time, we are also thinking about, you know, the potential cost and inconvenience to us, right? In addition, so people also tend to be susceptible to the present bias, right? That is, we overweigh a present interest to future outcomes, right? And so people have also been known to exhibit what's called the status quo bias, right? So where we are very resistant to change, you know, we do not want to change from our status quo because we are afraid that we might incur certain losses, right? And therefore, we try to avoid them. So you might be thinking, right, so even for people who actually are environmentally conscious, why are they not potentially, you know, engaging in some of these environmentally friendly behaviors? So one of the potential reasons is that they might perceive their actions as having a very low impact, right? So it's like a drop in the bucket. So is what I'm going to do really going to change things really matter, right? And I think besides, this issue is further compounded by the fact that the link between our actions and outcomes, you know, tend to be pretty abstract and uncertain, right? So together, these barriers might explain why in environmental sustainability, we often see an attitude-behavior gap, right? So even though we might have the right attitude, even though we might have the best intentions, these intentions might not translate into actual behavior. So what can we do to address this gap? So it turns out that this important question has drawn lots and lots of research in various fields, right? And so so in particular, I would like to share with everyone a framework that was actually published in the Journal of Marketing just last year that actually encapsulates, you know, many of these ideas and concepts that have been tested in the field, right? So, and this is the SHIFT framework, as what Kelvin was alluding to, right? And so the SHIFT framework, you know, is designed to actually shift people to behave more in a more environmentally sustainable way. So what does SHIFT stand for? Social influence, right? Habit formation, individual self, feelings and cognitions, and tangibility, right? So let's now take a closer look at each of these five pillars of the SHIFT framework, right? Social influence. So we live in a social environment, and therefore, you know, perhaps like naturally, you know, we tend to be influenced by what other people do, you know, what we think other people would expect us to do, and sometimes even by the mere presence of others, right? And so I think this might explain the power of social norms, right? So if we find out that others are taking certain actions, we might also be likely to conform, right, to the same behavior, right? And we often do things because we want to be seen in a positive light by others, right? And also the extent to which we identify with some of these social groups, right? Whether it's our friends, our family, or even our country as a whole, that might strengthen the effects of some of these social norms, right? So perhaps the best demonstration of social norms is a pretty well-known study that was conducted by a team of researchers in the US in collaboration with a hotel. Right? So in this particular study, the researchers randomly assigned about 200 rooms over a period of 80 days, right, to one of three conditions. So in the first condition, hotel guests see this sort of very standard message, right, in a hangar, right, to help save the environment, right, do things, you know, for the environment. Right? In the second condition, hotel guests see this message that says, you know, help us to save the environment. So for every time when you reuse your towel, we're actually going to donate some of these energy savings to a charity, right, a nonprofit organization. And finally, in the third condition, interestingly, hotel guests saw these messages instead, right? So about 75% of the guests actually participated in this program and reused their towels, right? So what the researchers found was that in the first two conditions, whereas hotel guests were about 40% likely to reuse their towels, these proportion actually increased significantly to 48% in the third condition, thereby you know, demonstrating the power of social norms. Moving on to the second pillar of the SHAPE framework, we have habit formation. So as we know, a lot of behaviors that we engage in, right, that are environmentally friendly, they are really not just one-off actions, right? They require repeated actions, which also means that, you know, we need to form new good habits, but we also need to break bad old habits, right? So what are some of the common tools and methods, you know, that we can use to encourage the formation of good habits, right? We have monetary fines and incentives, right? So we punish people for doing the wrong thing, but we also incentivize them with monetary rewards to encourage them to do the right thing. We can also, you know, perhaps make it easier for them to take certain desirable actions. We might remind them, right, what is right, what is the wrong thing to do, you know, and we might also give them feedback as to whether they're on the right track. And finally, implementation intentions. So implementation intentions here means that we ask people to start thinking about how they are going to implement these goals, you know, rather than, you know, still deliberating as to whether they want to do this or not, right? So let me illustrate this with an example. So in a study that was published in 2006, so this study was conducted with employees at a telecommunications company in the Netherlands. So among these employees, some of them were actually asked to make implementation intentions. That is, they were asked to plan explicitly when, where, and how they were going to recycle their old paper as well as used paper cups, and also to visualize and write down the actual action plans. So interestingly, in this study, the researchers found that these participants or these employees who were asked to make implementation intentions over a period of two months, they were significantly less likely to generate waste, and they were also more likely to recycle in the correct way, right? Compared to people, the other of their colleagues, or people who were simply given a personal recycling box. Moving to the third pillar of the SHAPE framework, individual self. So even though we live in a social environment, we are influenced by the behaviors of others, we are also individuals, right? So therefore, when we take certain actions, we want to see ourselves as doing the right thing, right? So we want to see ourselves as being consistent and not fickle-minded, and we also want to see ourselves as unique individuals, right? To illustrate the power of self-identity on waste reduction, I'm going to share with you this study. So, you know, these are typical bins that you see in public space, right? So general waste, you know, on a recyclables bin, right? So in this study, about 200 participants were recruited for a market research study. So they were asked to try out and test the quality of a pen, and they were asked to rate, you know, whether this pen is good or bad quality, right? So half of these participants were asked to write the brand name of the pen, Avery, five times on a piece of paper, whereas the other half of the participants were actually asked to write their last name or the surname, right? So participants, therefore, were randomly assigned to either the control condition on the left or the self-identity condition on the right. And what the researchers did was to look at the propensity for these participants to recycle the piece of paper after when they leave the room. Right? And so what the researchers found was that in the control condition, there was a recycling rate of 23%. In the self-identity condition, these increased significantly to 36%. So what these results illustrate is that, you know, when our actions are tied to who we are, we might tend to take more personal responsibility, you know, for how we behave, and therefore we might behave in the right way. So moving to the fourth pillar of the shift framework, feelings and cognition. So a lot of behavioral science research has shown that, you know, when people make decisions, they might engage one or two different systems, right? So system one tends to be more automatic, more feeling-based driven. So we have seen, for example, examples of habits. So habits are sort of automatic, like habitual behavior, right? System two, on the other hand, is more logic-driven, right? More analytical, more deliberative, right? So if we think about these two paths, we can potentially design interventions that could encourage sustainable behaviors, right? So for example, system one, so we can think of how we could induce both negative feelings, such as guilt, fear, or positive feelings, such as pride and hope, to encourage people to reduce waste and to engage in other sustainable behaviors, right? In terms of system two, we are all very familiar with messaging on flyers, posters, public education, that actually tell us, you know, what is a good thing to do, what is not so great things to do, you know, and the consequences. So here, I'll also like to highlight the role of salient visual cues, which are sort of like very subtle cues that could nudge people in making the right actions, in taking the right actions. And I think a very good example is what Hamer and Tommy shared earlier, you know, with the recycling right bin. Right? So let me give you another example. So here are sort of like the very standard bins that we see in public space. But let's compare these bins with these other bins that were actually tested in the workplace as well as, you know, some of the colleges in the US. Right? So the first thing that you will see is that the bins are not exactly the same size. Right? Right? So the recycling bin is actually bigger, the waste only bin is smaller. Right? The other thing that you see is that there is also some kind of a spit bump. Right? So the waste-only bin even has a cover. So that before you actually decide whether you're going to put anything inside, you know, is that really waste? Or is that something that you can potentially recycle? So these bins have actually been shown to reduce sort of waste by about 25% while increasing the recycling rate. So finally, I'd like to talk a little bit about the last pillar, tangibility. So as we've discussed earlier, so a lot of actions that we take, you know, and the link between these actions and outcomes, they tend to be pretty uncertain, very abstract, and they feel kind of psychologically very far away, right? So what are some of the potential solutions that we can use to increase the tangibility or the causal link or the perceived causal link between our actions and outcomes, right? The first thing we could do is to think of creative ways to communicate the benefits of waste reduction in very concrete terms. We could also emphasize why some of these actions, you know, have direct impact on you, you know, either in space or in time. And finally, and this is very much in line with what Jonathan shared with the shared things, that, you know, we could think of how to encourage the reuse of products, right? So, and more generally, you know, how could we encourage consumers to consume less material goods but more experiential goods, right? So this brings us to sort of like the growing trend towards a sharing economy as well as minimalistic lifestyles, right? And so I'm going to talk about this final study, right? And this is a study that further illustrates the power of tangibility, and this was published in an award-winning paper last year, right? So the researchers did a study after a football game, right? So in a control condition, so these party goers, right, were shown this regular poster, right? Recycle, you know, help the environment. In the other condition, there was a slight tweak to the poster. So in this poster, the researchers made the transformation of these recyclable products into new products very salient to participants, and as a result, they achieved astonishing results, right? And so 19% of the participants in the control condition recycled their used bottles and cans, whereas these increased significantly to 58% in the product transformation condition. So here's, let's take another look at the SHIFT framework, right? So you might be thinking right now, oh, you know, this is all theory, you know, these are all concepts. Like, surely people might experience lots of difficulty, you know, when they try to apply, you know, some of these things in the real world, right? So what are some of the practical challenges that we might face, you know, when we translate some of these ideas into practice? Right, I'm just gonna highlight a few of them. So the first is that, you know, consumers are very different from one another, right? So not just demographically, but we have very different attitudes, very different beliefs, different motivations, and these suggest that, you know, a one-size-fits-all solution does not exist, right? Number two is this idea of green fatigue, right? So lots of programs, lots of messaging, but to what extent would people feel this sense of overloadingness, right? For lack of a better word, right? So they might feel tired, right? And so so over time, you know, people might sort of like automatically tune out, you know, when they see these messages, or worse, they might even react negatively to some of these messages. And finally, so some of these techniques and methods that we have seen earlier, like social norms, you know, like monetary rewards and punishments, they tend to be tied very closely to extrinsic motivation, right? However, perhaps an over-focus on extrinsic motivation could actually lead to what economists would call a crowding out effect. It might interfere with our intrinsic motivation to do the right thing, right? And this potentially is problematic, especially if we want a lot of these actions to be sustainable over time. So these practical challenges together strongly suggest that, you know, as we move forward, you know, in our continued quest towards achieving a zero-waste nation, a zero-waste campus, it is important for us to really use a multi-pronged approach that consists of different components in order to address such great diversity, you know, in people, in attention, as well as in motivation. And thank you very much. So with that, thank you very much for your attention and also for inviting me to share these ideas and findings with you.